star burns in the darkness, shines with a promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel. We're singing glory, glory.
Good evening, everyone. You made it to our first ever outdoor drive-in adoration night / confession going on. We call these things, in the past couple years, we call them encounter. And one of those reasons we call them encounter was because in these moments, you were encountering Christ, whether it was through adoration, through community, through the music, through one another. So it was just this beautiful opportunity that we can encounter Christ in this powerful way to be encouraged and to hopefully share that faith with other people. I started to call these things XLT just as another form of praise and worship, because I think that in anything, one of our goals and hopes is that we're able to praise our God, to have this opportunity to be in his presence and to exalt and praise who he is in our lives. So in a way, these nights are a call for celebration, but also a call just to be together. And especially right now when things are so crazy, and I'm not going to talk too much about 2020 and all that stuff, because we could write a whole history book on just that alone. But I just wanted an opportunity for especially the teens in our program and confirmation, our families, and this chance to be together and to pray together. And though it may not be the same as years past where we've, you know, have and on the same church in different places, but I feel like this is still a pretty cool thing where we're actually all together and in this time. So how this night is going to work is that we're going to have some music, we'll have a speaker, we'll have a time of adoration, we'll also have time for confession. One note for adoration is that Jesus will be here where we have this beautiful altar set up. Then at some point, we'll actually have Jesus brought out into the crowd, into the cars, and have him process through as a way that even though if you're in the far backs and the nosebleeds of the parking lot, you'll still hopefully have a close encounter with Christ. The other part is confession. If you're interested in confession, we actually have three priests available over here. You can line up along the wall, and we've actually had a line starting. And at this point, you can actually go to confession whenever you feel like. So this is open for the teens, for the parents, for the grandparents, to the uncle, aunt, whatever. You guys are more than welcome to come. We have three priests. They're here for you guys to hear your confessions. And so please feel free to utilize the sacrament whenever you feel like. I've been told that there are some that may not be able to leave their cars. And so if that's one of you, we actually will have Father Brandon and one of our leaders, Michaela, over here. And they'll actually be walking by some of the cars. And if you need to have confession, they can actually maybe hear you by your car. So that way you can't get out or can't walk up the stairs. Now, if you see Father Brandon, which Father Brandon, if you can raise your hand a little bit here, he's right over there, dressed in white, looks like a priest, good chance. go ahead and like send a blinker out so that way we know that you're kind of wanting confession, and then Michaela will kind of get the signal and we'll bring you over there. So you don't have to do that the whole night, because then your car will probably die and that'll be a whole other issue. But once you see the man in white that looks like a priest coming by, that's a good time to say, oh, I need to go, and then send that blinker over. Lastly, there's a lot of ways that we have this stream. Obviously, you have the screen. You can hopefully see it with your eyes. It is on our parish streaming website on our YouTube. It's on our website. Find where we normally show Mass on a Sunday and daily Mass. And lastly, on the FM radio, 91.3, I believe, is correct. So that is where that is, too, if you'd like to listen to it in your cars, if this is not loud enough for you. So with that said, we're going to start this night off with just some music, some worship with our musicians, and here we go. Oh, so let's go ahead and pray. So, in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord God, we praise and thank you so much for this opportunity, for this night, and this chance to be together as a community, to be able to pray, to worship, and to just reverence you as our God. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and Lord, help us to be vulnerable tonight. Help us to get rid of any distractions that are preventing us from really entering in and just to put you first at this time. Help us to put away our phones, to stop conversation, and just focus on you right now. Open our hearts and help us to be ready just to be in your presence, to have this quality time. In your name we pray.
there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is
become more aware.
we get to meet in this wonderful season of Advent. Advent, unlike Lent, is a time of joyful waiting. We're waiting for this incredible event. One way that I had a middle school night a few weeks ago, and one way I described it is like joyfully preparing for someone to arrive. Like something that you're super excited for, something that you're preparing for. So if you're going to a concert, you know, you're getting your gear ready, you're getting, you know, maybe, you know, actually I don't go to many concerts, but you know, that type of thing where you're getting ready for a concert, or maybe getting ready for a family member, you know, get the bed ready, maybe get some groceries for food, maybe it's a holiday so you get some presents, or whatever you need to prepare because you're getting excited for this thing, this person that's coming our way. Advent is that time for us as Catholics, that we're getting ready for the King of the Universe to be born into this world, and where we're able to celebrate that our Savior is coming. He is here. And I guess that is kind of, you know, we kind of already know that, spoiler alert, you know, that, hey, it's happening. But it's that reminder to us that we should always be excited for his coming, always ready for this hopeful time, no matter what's going on in the world, no matter what's happening throughout, that Jesus is here, Jesus is coming. So I'm not going to talk the whole time. I have an amazing speaker. He's the youth minister from St. Martin's. His name is Tanner. And he's going to be sharing a bit of just what this hope means. This hope means in this time period, hope in the world, hope in our faith, and how that all connects. And he's a man that's full of hope, full of joy. He's a lot of energy, and I've had the great honor of getting to know him throughout these last few years at various youth ministry events. I got married at the church that he ministers at St. Martin's, and so I've seen him just all over the place in different things. So I'm super excited that you get to hear him, and here's Tanner, everyone.
Oh my gosh, so welcoming and not forced. I love it. how's everybody doing? My name's Tanner. One second, please. Okay. So my name is Tanner Hargy. As Garrick said, I'm a youth minister. I work for the church. You know, that means I'm a professionally awkward and uncomfortable person. And I am so glad to be here tonight. Can we just go ahead and give Garrick a round of applause for putting this whole thing together? Like, honestly, so, so blessed to have Garrick. To have Garrick here. I unfortunately don't have that much time to share with you, and so what I'd like to do in my few minutes that I do have, let me just make sure I don't go overboard. What I'm going to do in the few minutes that I do have with you is I want to be able to get to know you guys a little bit, just because I was speaking to some people beforehand, before the event started, and man, it was so good to talk to people and get to know people again after all that time by yourself. And so I'm just going to ask you three questions, and so all these questions are going to do is, do you like this, do you like that, and I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand a little bit, just quick thing. There's no way you can get this wrong. I'm not going to quiz you on anything. Just a way for us to help be on the same page with each other. So the first question I have is I'm going to go ahead and ask. There's two movies that you can watch. Okay, there's Elf and there's Home Alone. Raise your hand if you were picking Elf over Home Alone. Raise your hand. Elf, nice. Buddy the Elf, what's your favorite color? I love it, hands down. All right, next, raise your hand if you're going to be picking Home Alone out of the two movies. Yes, okay, there's some Home Alone people here. I love it. The next question I have is one of the most fiercely, hotly debated questions I've ever seen as a youth minister, which is The Nightmare Before Christmas a Halloween movie or a Christmas movie? I've heard both things, and people get very passionate about this type of conversation. So raise your hand if you think it's a Halloween movie. Raise your hand. A few people. Nice. It's okay. We'll pray for you, okay? Raise your hand if you know that it's a Christmas movie. See, that's what I'm saying. Like, Christmas is a majority of the movie. Halloween is the first 2 minutes. Sorry, it's what it is. I don't make the rules, okay? And the final question I have is, if I was going to come up to you and say, would you like a surprise? Are you the kind of person that says, yeah, I love surprises, a world of possibility, you know, surprise birthday parties, Christmas presents, I love surprises? Or are you the kind of person when you hear surprise, you hear, like, you don't hear surprise, you hear surprise, and you think of, like, you know, I don't like being in the, not being in the know. I don't know what's going on. I like to be part of everything. Don't surprise me. Are you the person who likes surprises? Raise your hand if that's you, if you like surprises. Okay, nice. I see it. Hands down. Raise your hand if you do not like surprises. You like to be in the know. See, there's people out there. I know. And I know for me personally, when I think about why might someone like or not like a surprise, I think that you probably associate it with good and bad surprises. If you would like surprises, that means you've probably gotten good Christmas presents in the past where you're like, it's everything that I wanted. You're going looking under the tree and you see a box and you go like, oh my gosh, is it a PS5? Spoiler alert, this year it's not a PS5. And you're just like super excited and ready for this surprise that's going to come. And if you don't like surprises, chances are it's because there's been some bad surprises that you've experienced in your time. There's been some bad surprises, some bad Christmas presents maybe, or just like, I remember when I was 13 years old, I went to my grandma's house in the morning and was just asking, where's my gift? Who got me in the gift exchange? And it was my uncle, and so he came over to me and said, Merry Christmas, and he handed me this box, and I opened it, and it was a book on conjugating Spanish verbs along with a 3-ring binder and lined paper. It's like, Merry Christmas, here's a homework assignment, you know? And it was the worst present I've ever gotten, you know? But I think about what makes a present bad, what makes a surprise present disappointing. It's when you have all of these hopes and expectations about what you could be getting. You see the gifts starting to compile under the Christmas tree, and you're going, oh, I wonder if that's one of these, or the box looks like that shape, so I wonder if it could be what I want. And you have all this hope and anticipation, and then it lets you down. And then it lets you down. It's not what you wanted it to be. And I know that for many of us, if we were looking back at where we were in December of 2019, chances are it was kind of like Christmas Eve when you haven't opened the present yet. Chances are it was like Christmas Eve when you're going, I wonder what 2020 is going to hold for me. I know that every single person had some type of hope for 2020, a new year, a new decade, all of that. And then all of a sudden, it was a bad Christmas gift. It was a bad surprise. For some of you, you may have been looking at 2020, you've been, wow, I can't wait. I'm hoping to graduate this year. I'm hoping to graduate, to be able to go and spend time with my friends before we all depart and go to different colleges. I can't wait for that. Some of you may be going, oh, this is the year I'm going to get confirmed. I can't wait to go. 2 years of preparation of time, and now at this big ceremony, this big mass, I'm going to receive the grace of the Spirit, right? Others of you may have been looking at 2020 going, you know, maybe this is the year I get that promotion. Maybe this is going to be the year I get to be tight with my family again. Maybe this is going to be the year that I go dive deeper into my faith. All of this hope and expectation was placed into 2020 and what it was going to be. And surprise, it wasn't any of those things. And then we're left here a whole year later looking back going, what happened? Surprise, schools got closed. Surprise, there was a sickness. Surprise, you can't go and you're supposed to hate everybody now. Surprise, there's curfews because it's dangerous outside. Surprise, you can't see your friends and family. Surprise, jobs are closing. Surprise. And on top of that, the whole place that you were told you can always run to, the place that you could go to, I'm gonna grab this, man. The place that you were told you can go to, that was home, that was safe, that you were told you could trust all of that time, surprise, you're not supposed to go there anymore. And in fact, not only can you not go there, but in some places it's illegal for you to go there. And now, here we are, find ourselves after all of that, and you're going, you're going to give me a talk about hope after all that I've seen this past year? Don't you dare tell me about hope. Because think about it like this. When we get a Christmas present that's not good, a bad Christmas present, chances are afterwards, we're kind of left asking the questions like, did they even know me? Did they know what I wanted? Did they get my interests and what I loved? And yet we find ourselves here, and I guarantee you that these questions are here tonight, the questions of, if God was so good, why did all of this happen? If God was so loving, why would he just sit passively while all of this was going on? Does God care? Does God love? Because if God loved me, wouldn't he care about the loss of money that I wouldn't be able to provide? If God cared and loved me, wouldn't he take interest in the fact that I'm lonely and I'm sliding back into my old ways, into the sin, all of this? Because God's just watching me mess up, right? I think a lot of us have been thinking that. And if you're here and you're thinking that and you're full of doubts and you're here and you're afraid to hope, guess what? You're in good company, okay? I'm here to tell you that you're not bad for having these doubts. I'm here to tell you that no matter what, the year beat all of us up. It kicked us in the shins and pushed us over. And you know what? Here we are. And we're going to be talking about hope again. And I know so many of you are saying, how can we possibly hope in a time like this? Have you seen what's gone on? I have seen what's gone on. And no, God hasn't abandoned you. God hasn't just turned a blind eye. In fact, 2,000 years ago, there was a world just like this. I don't know if you knew this, but 2,000 years ago in Judea, which is around the area that Jesus was born, there was a power shift that was going on, leading the tribes of Judea to kind of separate into their own little groups, their own little camps that would look at the other camps that disagreed with each other, and they would destroy, and they would kill, and they would commit acts of violence. Sound familiar? I don't know if you know this, but in first century Rome, 95% of the population was living at or below the poverty line, with only the wealth being enjoyed by about 5% of the population. Sound familiar? 95% at or below the poverty line. I don't know if you know this, but over 50% of children in the early Roman Empire suffered from some type of malarial infection that they contracted in the streets because of how poorly upkept it was. I don't know if you know this, but King Herod, upon hearing that there was going to be a king that was going to come one day that was better than him, that would take his place, ordered the death of every child in the area 2 years old or below. I don't know if you know this, but I see a world there that was full of death, a world there that was full of despair, a world that was full of hopelessness, of poverty, of beating after beating. And now here we are 2,000 years later in the same exact spot. The same exact spot. We find ourselves approaching Christmas the same way people back then were approaching Christmas. And you're here telling me this has never happened before. It's never been this dark before. Yes, it has been, and it was right around Christmas time. See, I don't know if this is something you thought of, but last time we experienced a Christmas that was approaching that was this dark, God did his best work. And I don't know if you know this either, but when Jesus came down, oftentimes we look at nativity scenes, and we make them like this over nice, super sanitary, beautiful thing. But when Jesus came into this, I don't know if you've probably heard this before, that they were denied shelter everywhere they went, Mary and Joseph. And they ended up, I imagine, in like a little steeple shed thing that was probably in the middle of the wilderness. It was probably the middle of the night. It was cold. There was wind. And not only that, but if there were animals in there, like there's often depicted, there's probably dirt and hay and mud and animal feces everywhere. And it wasn't pretty. But the thing is, if you're experiencing a mess right now, good thing is we have the God of the mess that's going to be with us tonight. If you've been experiencing a mess this entire year, guess what? God came specifically for your mess. Because 2,000 years ago, when the world was in the biggest mess it's seen, then the hope that no one saw coming came into the world. Because here's the deal. So many of us are looking around going, I don't see any hope, because we're just looking around at what's in the mess already. We're saying, I can't put my hope in people because people let me down. I can't put my hope in my job. I can't put my hope in my career. I can't put my hope in family, in friends, in everything that's secure here. But the reality is this, none of that was supposed to be our hope to begin with. Because the hope we have as Christians, as Catholics, is that it's a hope that comes from outside of what we thought possible. And so guess what? Tonight, Jesus is going to be present with us. Hope is going to come into this situation, this mess that we have. See, when John writes about the birth of Jesus, okay, in John 1, it says right here, through him was life, and this life was the light of the human race. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. I don't know where you're experiencing darkness right now. I don't know where you need the hope of Christ right now. But the one thing that I do know that signifies the Christmas season, the Advent time, the preparing, the waiting, is that light and hope can and will come into this mess. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Maybe you're sitting here and you're going, Tanner, you don't get it, man. It's nice of you to say that hope can come into this mess, but I don't feel it. Do me a favor, take John 3:16 and take out the world and put you. For God so loved you that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. I don't know where you need light. I don't know where you need hope tonight. But the one thing I can urge you to do is to invite Jesus into this mess, into that hurting, into that darkness, into that void, that thing that's been hurting you, that's been ailing you all this time. Because Christmas was not the thing that just magically fixed everything in one night, but Christmas signified that there was going to be change, that hope had come. Because think about this, Christmas came, hope arrived. All of the best stuff that we talk about came after that. Why do you think people are so fascinated in the Gospels? Because it's God's best work. because Jesus came into the world. He took on human form, came into the biggest mess that humanity had ever seen. And then what happened at that point? He grew up. What happened after that? He started performing the biggest miracles. He started healing people. He started walking on water. And then what happened was he was crucified. And then what happened? He died and was buried. And then what happened after that? He rose from the grave. And then what happened after that? He started a church, Pentecost, the first Pope Peter, and then another Pope, and then another Pope, and then his disciples became bishops, and then became priests, and then 2,000 years later, here we are. This was all brought about by the change that Christmas brought. And so I'm not claiming that one little night can signify all this, can fix all of your problems. But what I am saying is that tonight, encountering Jesus, not singing the right songs, not hearing a talk, not feeling or experiencing anything, but just simply making a way for Jesus Christ, that is what can bring about change. If you want to see change in the new year, guess what? It starts here and is going to continue every day after this. So if you're here, that's what we're going to be doing tonight. See, the Eucharist is not some type of symbol. It's not just something that we think about or imagine and pretend is Jesus. It is physically, presently Jesus. Body, blood, soul, and divinity. Not this just type of abstract thing that we use to help illustrate the point, but actually Jesus, present here. And if we believe that, then that changes everything. If you're here and you're going, Tanner, I've experienced darkness this year that you can never imagine. Maybe you experienced darkness in relationships with family and friends. Maybe all that's just taken a toll this year. It's been beaten down one day after the other. And maybe you would invite Jesus into that tonight. God, would you shine your light into this relationship? Bring about healing, a sense of unity, a sense of love. Maybe you've been experiencing darkness in yours or someone's health. Maybe you've been experiencing darkness, whether it be a health, like you're actually sick and your body's breaking down, or whether it's something that's up in your head, something that's mental. Maybe invite Jesus into that to bring his healing grace into that part of your life as well. Maybe you may be going, Tanner, you don't understand. Death's already won this Advent season. Death's already won, and now you're going to be spending your first Christmas without somebody. But I promise you this. For every Christmas that someone misses down here, there's an eternal, ongoing Christmas up above, too. And I promise you that if I could pick between a Christmas here and a never-ending Christmas up there, I'm picking up there every time. Maybe let Jesus into the darkness that is grief. Maybe pray for whoever that is that you're going to be missing this Christmas season. Maybe you're going, Tanner, you don't understand. I haven't gone to church at all this pandemic. I haven't gone to confession. I haven't been to mass. I haven't prayed. I don't even know where to begin. I'm already too far gone. This year's kicked me way too many times, and now I'm here in this mess and don't know how to fix it. The beautiful thing is we have priests here to offer you the sacrament of confession tonight. Let them be Jesus to you. You don't have to feel bad about anything. You don't have to feel guilty about anything. They're just simply here to listen to you and forgive. And maybe for sometimes the most powerful thing for me is just hearing somebody in Jesus's place who says, you're not too bad. You're not that bad. You're not too far gone. You're not this awful person that you think you've become. See, the thing is this, brothers and sisters, hope is not just this far off thing. It's not this something that we can tangibly hold or see. It is not a what, it is a who. And tonight, hope is going to be brought into this situation. So maybe this year you've been hearing bad surprise after bad surprise. Allow Jesus to convince you that there still are good surprises. That there still are and can be and will be good surprises. Will you pray with me? In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. God, we come here tonight with a heart ready for hope. See, your people were in darkness for way too long. And now, tonight, you are going to be here. And if we truly believe that you, God, can physically be present here in the darkness the same way you were present 2,000 years ago, allow that to instill in us a fire that can bring about change into this world. Prepare our hearts for a surprise far bigger, far better than anything we could have ever imagined. Give us courage to respond
to your love, to respond to your healing grace, to not be like a bad patient who goes to the divine doctor and doesn't say what's wrong. You are the answer. You are the hope we've been looking for. And if we truly believe that you are that hope, allow us to come to you tonight with a heart desperate, longing for your saving grace, for your hope. We ask all this in your most heavenly name. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Tanner. There's a particular scripture verse that comes to mind, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in faith. The part escapes me right now. But the idea is that it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. That this world may have failed in every single way possible this year. Name it, and it probably happened this year. But the one who's going to come here tonight has never changed, has stayed consistent, remains who he is from 2,000 years ago from today. Jesus is coming. Jesus will be here. So as Tanner mentioned, no matter where you're at, you're never too far gone. That is the beauty of the Christian faith, that you can never go too far. You can never be too far away, but he is always relentlessly seeking you out. The church, not just the building, the church is not a waiting room for the saints, but a hospital for the sinners. We don't need perfect people. We need broken people that are willing to seek mercy and hope and love. So are you willing to seek that? Are you willing to put your life on the line for that? Because if you are, you're in the right place. Hope is here, and he is waiting. Tonight, you have a variety of ways to encounter Christ. And the music that we'll have playing has been described to me as times that sometimes with music explains thoughts are too deep for words, a sigh that is just inexplainable. Maybe you do not know what to say to our God. And so sing the songs, listen to the songs, and let that become your prayer. Let that capture what's being stirring up in your soul and be sent out into the heavens. Let that be what you want to say to God, and let that be that. The person of Christ is in those priests over here. Jesus is present in them. And so no matter what you've done or where you've gone, as Tanner had mentioned, they're here to hear confession. They're here tonight, so please take advantage of it. If you haven't gone in a month, in a year, in 7 years, in 20 years, I don't care. Jesus doesn't care. He doesn't get tired of forgiving us. We get tired of asking for forgiveness. So don't be afraid to ask for it. And lastly, the most importantly, the same Jesus that we receive in the Eucharist at Mass, we present sitting on this shiny thing, which is called the monstrance, almost like a throne. He'll be seated here. And this is a great time for just some good, solid, quality time, where you'll be here face to face and just to talk to him like you would talk to a friend, a relative, a loved one. And it won't end there, because this loved one won't just sit here. He'll have to come out to you and to be right there in front of you. So wherever you're at, just be ready, because he's coming and he wants to be here with you. And he's just waiting, knocking at the door, waiting for you to respond. So prepare your hearts, be ready, and just be prepared to say yes and to enter in, no matter where you're at.
Take a few minutes just to reflect on this past year. on perhaps some worries that we might have, some frustrations. And we can just offer that up during this time of prayer when Jesus is before us. And sometimes things don't make sense to us. Same time, we're not the creator of the universe either. So let's just pray and ask for humility and ask God to increase our trust in Him and increase our hope that He uses everything for our good. So you are here.
You are here. Moving in our midst, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. So you are here. You are here. Moving in our midst, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here. Mending every heart. I worship you. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it.
feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop working. You never stop working.
My heart is an open space for you. saying, where are you going? My heart is open wide, my eyes are open wide. What are you saying? Where are you going? My heart is open wide, my eyes are open wide. My heart is an open space for you to come. Have your way, I'm open. I'm open. My heart is an open space for you to come. Have your way, I'm open. I'm open.
I just want to sit here at your feet, caught up in this holy moment, never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sing another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Caught up in your presence, I just want to sit here at your feet. Never wanna leave.
for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry, and I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Caught up in your presence.
Thank you.
take the bread of life, broken for all my sin, your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice to trade this sinner's end for your new covenant. Christ is formed in me.
I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. The sin runs deep, your grace is more. The grace is found, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Stand out for you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand out for you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, I need you.
Quake before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Through it all, my eyes are on. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. for me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well. It is well. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul.
Just want to remind everyone that confessions are still going on. If anybody would like to go, I'm over there.
go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. Oh, you go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness. All I do is praise. All I do is worship. It was bowed down. All I did was stay still.
Put me back together.
it was praise. All I need to do is worship your holy name. All I did was bow down. Oh, I'm gonna stay still. I'll stay still.
Blessed be God. Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most
precious blood. Blessed be his most precious blood.
Precious blood.
Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete.
Blessed be the Great Mother of God, Mary Most Holy.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be her immaculate, her holy and immaculate conception.
Her holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be her glorious Assumption.
Glorious Assumption.
Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse. Blessed be God and his angels and in his saints.
trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great. Age to age he stands. Age to age he stands. Time is in his hands. Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. The Godhead. How great. Good all the time. If you love Jesus, honk your horns.
That's awesome. Some people really love Jesus out there, and then some people are like, "Shush, you guys, we're trying to sleep out here, guys." No, it's good. It happens like once. Well, actually, it's only happened once, so maybe they won't know it's us. Thank you so much for being out here and saying yes, and to, you know, I've heard it called a date with Jesus. So if you haven't done something like this before, you just went on your first date, but maybe you've done this before, so maybe you just went out to lunch with Jesus, you know, like kind of hanging out. So you had some solid quality time, and I'm glad that, I hope that God reached you some way. Whatever that is, God is continuing to work, and, you know, what's cool about this is that this is just not a one-off thing, but we get to receive him every single Sunday, and some people every single day at Mass. So this is not just, oh, like a one-time thing, but hopefully you continue that relationship there too. Same thing with confession. You know, it's always there every single Saturday, 3:30 to 4:30. And so if you're ever looking for confession, our parish is always offering it. Super quick, this is not just an event. Like, this is not just like a professional event put on. This is a group of parishioners, volunteers, people that just said yes and are here to just serve and help, and they're part of our community. So this is not just like, you know, in the woodworks, but you know a lot of these people. You've seen a lot of these people in the background, whether in confirmation as teen leaders or youth leaders, adult leaders, people that help in hospitality, AV. So these are people from our parish that are just coming together to put on this event for each of you. So that being said, there are a lot of people to thank, and I'll go pretty quick. And if I talk too fast, you may email me and ask me what I said later. So super quick, our three priests out here, Father Mike, our pastor, Father Joseph, and Father Brandon. He's the vocations director, actually. So if you ever have a question about your vocation, Father Brandon over there is your man. So he's the tall one. He plays basketball sometimes. I've seen him play. He's really good. Anyways, there's a used to be a seminarian versus priest thing, and he's awesome. Anyways, so that's totally off topic. Another thank you is our musicians, Brian and Gina. How are they? They were great. they were awesome. So thank you guys for just leading our worship and praying with us. Thank you to the AV team. These are guys that set up the cameras, the projectors, the making this possibly live stream, the FM radio, and they're not just doing this tonight. They were here this morning at like 6, doing the 7:30 a.m., the 9 a.m., the 11 a.m. They do this every single day to 6:30 a.m., and they help with whatever our parish needs. They'll be here for Christmas time. And so, again, parishioners just saying yes and volunteering, and they're here all the time. So a huge thank you to them. Real quick, thank you guys for them. And also, you know, if you ever want to help them out, they're always looking for volunteers to help spread out the ranks so they're not doing it all the time. So I need to put a little plug in there because they do such an amazing job. Thank you to Tanner, our speaker, who gave an amazing message and just for being here and spending time with us. Thank you to James Abaud. He's our Faith Formation Director who is just here and helping out and doing filling in everything that we need. To our leaders that were outside. So a lot of the team that's helping out are, again, a mixture of hospitality ministers to our confirmation leaders, and they're spread out from people that set up the altar to help with music, Kelvin over here, to people that help with the parking lot and directing things. So thank you to all these guys and to all help. To our altar servers, too, that carried the candles around. I know those things are kind of heavy, so you guys are amazing. Thank you to you two for doing that. I think... hopefully I didn't miss anyone, and if not, God will thank you in heaven. Deacons, oh my gosh, the deacons. Deacon Chuck and Deacon Henry. Thank you, my wife, Kristen, who reminded me. Yes, the deacons brought Jesus all the way around, and they were here tonight, and so thank you to them, too, for just doing that. So thank you to them as well. That is all my thank yous. It is about 7:56, so 4 minutes before 8, so I've done beforehand, so thank you so much for being here. Please don't run over anyone on your way out. It's kind of dark out here. That would be a terrible way to end a night. Be joyful and hopeful. The exits, you have some people, the guys out there as well, and just exit carefully and slowly, and try to avoid running over to people in the front here and go through the backside. So thank you so much. Have a good night, and you guys are amazing.